Hello, boys and girls. This is a story that I like to call Peter and the Wolf. Are you sitting comfortably?
Are you?
Good. Then let's begin. Each character is represented by a different instrument of the synthesized orchestra. For instance, the part of Billy the Bird is played by a flute, like this. The part of Bruce the Duck is played by an oboe. Louis the Cat is a clarinet.
All right, he's not really a clarinet, he's just... You know, he's represented by a clarinet.
The part of the grandfather will be played by Don Ameche. He...
What? You couldn't make it.
Okay, in that case, the part of the grandfather will be played by... a bassoon. Three French horns play the part of...
Three French horns play...
The wolf!
It's the wolf!
Right. The wolf. Seymour the Wolf. The kettle drum and bass drum represent the submachine gun fire of the hunters. And of course, as always, the part of Bob the janitor is played by the accordion. Well, that's it for the introductions. And now, the story. A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, Once upon a time, I think it was last Thursday, a boy named Peter opened the gate and went out into the big green meadow. On the branch of a big tree sat a little bird.
Owl is quiet,
said the bird.
How
Holy cow! A talking bird!
Thought Peter. Just then, Bruce the duck came waddling by. Bruce was very happy that Peter hadn't closed the gate, and he decided to check out the deep pond in the meadow. Bird saw the duck, so he decided to fly down and pick an argument with him.
What kind of bird are you if you can't fly?
He said, to which the duck cleverly replied,
I'm a duck, stupid!
Argued and argued, the duck swimming in the pond, the little bird skipping along the shore. Sorry. Suddenly, something caught Peter's eye. And you know how painful that can be. It was Louis the cat crawling through the grass. Louis the cat thought,
The bird is busy arguing. I'll just grab him.
So quietly, Louis crept towards him on his velvet paws.
Well, his paws weren't really velvet. They were, you know, kind of like velvet. A metaphor. It's a metaphor. Get it?
Look out!
Advised Peter. The bird immediately flew up into the tree. While Bruce the Duck quacked at Louis the Cat, from the middle of the pond. Louis the Cat walked around the tree and thought,
Is it worth climbing up so high? Or should I just send out for pizza?
Grandfather came out. He was all bent out of shape because Peter had gone into the meadow.
It's a dangerous place. If a wolf should come out of the forest, then what would you do, huh?
Peter did not answer because, after all, it was a rhetorical question. Boys like Peter are afraid of a lot of things, like nuclear annihilation and flunking algebra, but they're not afraid of wolves. Grandfather got Peter in a headlock and dragged him home, telling him that he was grounded and that he couldn't watch any cartoons for 3 weeks. As luck would have it, a big, mean, hairy, ferocious, snarling, carnivorous wolf did come out of the forest. But I guess we all knew that was coming. I mean, this story's called Peter and the Wolf. We couldn't very well call it Peter and the Wolf if there was no wolf, could we? That'd be really stupid. Was up the tree in a twinkling, which is about, 2.3 seconds.
Oh. Bruce the duck quacked so hard that he propelled himself backwards and up onto dry land.
For those of you taking notes, this is a fine practical example of Newton's first law of motion, which clearly states that for every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction.
But no matter how quickly Bruce tried to waddle away, he couldn't escape Seymour the wolf, who was wearing his best pair of tennis shoes. The wolf was closing in on the duck. He was getting closer. And closer. And closer. And then with one big gulp, Seymour wolfed him down. Let me recap the story briefly in case you just walked into the room. Louis the cat was sitting on one branch. Billy the bird was on another branch. Not too close to Louis. And Bob the janitor was at home, defrosting his refrigerator. The wolf walked around the tree so many times that he made a small trench. Meanwhile, Peter was standing behind the closed gate, videotaping everything that was going on. Suddenly, Peter got an idea. He ran home and got a big spool of his grandfather's unwaxed dental floss. One of the branches of the tree that the wolf was circling was conveniently stretched out over a high stone wall. Peter scaled the wall lickety-split, which is even faster than a twinkling. Then he grabbed the branch and climbed onto the tree. Peter said to Billy the bird,
I want you to fly down and circle around the wolf's head to distract him. But be very careful he doesn't catch you and back. bash your skull in and tear out your lungs and chew you up into itsy bitsy teeny tiny little pieces.
Okay,
said the bird.
The bird almost touched the wolf's head with his wings while the wolf snapped angrily at him.
Go ahead,
said the wolf.
Make my day. Come on, cut it out,
snarled the wolf.
You're asking for trouble, punk.
But Billy the Bird just kept on harassing him.
Meanwhile, Peter made a lasso out of the dental floss. And carefully letting it down,
caught the wolf by the tail and pulled with all his might. Feeling himself caught, the wolf got really ticked off and started jerking back and forth. Peter tied the other end of the dental floss to the tree and left the wolf dangling in midair.
Hey, big bad wolf,
said Peter.
Why don't you come up here and get us now?
I would,
said the wolf.
But, well, I'm kind of tied up right now.
Just then, some members of the National Rifle Association came out of the woods, firing their magnums, Uzis, and bazookas.
Thank you.
yelled,
"Don't shoot! Billy the bird and I have caught the wolf! Now, let's take him to the zoo!"
"Great idea,"
said the hunters.
"And if he likes that, next week we'll take him to Disneyland!"
Imagine the victory parade. Peter was at the head. But after a few minutes, he was through, and then the parade began with Peter at the very front. The hunters leading Seymour the Wolf. The janitor, who had to sweep up the whole mess. Grandfather shook his head discontentedly.
"Well, Peter, what if you hadn't caught the wolf? What then?"
"Well,"
said Peter,
"he probably would have ripped out my intestines with his teeth."
said Grandfather.
"I know that, you idiot. It was a rhetorical question."
Billy the bird chirped proudly.
"Yeah, that's right. We bad. We bad."
Mm-hmm.
Grandfather decided that he'd had enough of the pond and the meadow and the whole stinking scene, so he ran off to Los Angeles and joined a heavy metal band. And what about Bruce the Duck? Well, the wolf had been in such a hurry that he swallowed him alive. Which means the gastric juices slowly dissolved his body and he died a long, painful death. However, you'll be happy to hear that just a few years later, he was reincarnated as Shirley MacLaine. And the moral of the story is, oral hygiene is very important. Make sure you see your dentist at least twice a year. This is a new composition which features a random assortment of all living creatures. You'll find that it's not quite exactly the same as the one by Camille Saint... what's his name? Camille, in his research, was slightly behind, and I guess that some critters just plain slipped his mind. So to fill in this void in the animal kingdom, I'll read some new verses. I'm not gonna sing them. Now kindly shut up, and I'll narrate for you Carnival of the Animals, Part 2. The aardvark is really a curious creature. If you're an ant, then he's likely to eat you. Although his long nose makes him look rather hideous, he's still listed first in the encyclopedias. I love to watch the hummingbirds just hovering for hours. They look like mini helicopters pollinating flowers. And yet I still feel sorry for the little hummingbirds. They always have to hum because they never learn the words. Thank you.
learned a few things in my life about snails. They don't care for salt, and they leave icky trails. It's pretty darn hard to tell one from the other, and French people like them with garlic and butter.
Inside the murky swamp, there lives the alligator. His policy is first to chomp and then ask questions later. Although his lifestyle may seem crass, I really wouldn't knock it. He'd never wear a shirt that has a yuppie on the pocket. Amoeba is so small you need a microscope to see one. It hurts the eyes, but I'll concede I'd rather see than be one. They never sing or laugh or talk or eat fondue or quiche. And if you take one for a walk, you need a tiny leash. I know the thing must have a brain, although I couldn't tell you where. It sure must be an awful pain to be so unicellular.
Thank you.
Pigeons are such reprehensible things. Some critics, I'm told, call them rodents with wings. They terrorize folks with their constant dive bombing, which some find distasteful and some quite alarming. But still, they fulfill an invaluable need. They give old men on park benches something to feed. In return for this honor, all they ask is that you allow them to soil the occasional statue. The shark is not a friendly fish. That fact it's always proving. It seems this creature's favorite dish is anything that's moving. He'll chew your face off in a flash, or cheat you if you let him. So never loan him any cash, and be careful when you pet him. Some think the cockroach is a pest, but that's the insect I like best. I love the way they run in fright when I turn on the kitchen light. And when I squish them on the ground, they make a pleasant crunching sound. Thank you. I could tell you a story about the iguana, but right at the moment, I don't really wanna. The life of the vulture is one long sick joke. He hangs around waiting for something to croak, and then picks the carcass right down to the bone. Reminds me of one or two lawyers I've known. The unicorn is just a horse, excepting for its horn, of course. The unicorn is just a myth, which is to say, they don't exist.
Thank you.
The poodle's a slimy, carnivorous beast. In pastures, you might find it grazing. Its fangs measure 23 inches at least. Its antlers are simply amazing. Sometimes it will bury its head in the sand. It's our main source of pork, ham, and bacon. But then again, on the other hand, I could be completely mistaken. Getting late, so I suppose we should be drawing to a close. Besides, my voice is sounding hoarse, and even my rhymes are getting worse. Poor Wendy's feeling in the dumps. She's worn her fingers down to stumps. And so, farewell. This record's through. Now, go find something else to do.